Welcome to End of the World Satsang. That's what it really is, isn't it? Here's where you get the inside scoop of what's really taking place. Why is it taking place the way that it is? And it's really something that we've never considered, has never been brought to the attention, as far as I know. And the idea of satsang is you sit comfortably, calmly, with your attention fully available, and you consider what's being said from an objective, non-reactive viewpoint. You don't try to do anything with the information. It's like getting a suntan. You just sit out in the sun and you get the suntan. You don't try to do anything with the sun. It just happens by being out in the sun. Same thing with satsang. You just listen, and by hearing what's being said, there's a certain effect of clarification taking place. Now, I've promised that I would let the cat out of the bag and explain what's really taking place in the world by July 4th, 2011. So that's what I have done here. We're talking about the second half of the year 2011 and the impending collapse of the financial structure of this planet, and with it the economic and social structure as well. It's a complete collapse is going to take place. And you may feel that, that's not a spiritual subject, but I tell you, it's the most spiritual subject of all. Because in following this, finding out what the purpose of it is, you get the big picture of existence and what your place in it really is. I've mentioned that this collapse is intentional in another video. It's intentional. It's done on purpose. It's done by design. The design is very clever. Design is very effective. Design is going to work. There are those who will pull the trigger on this collapse, and it's going to happen. But all the world is a stage, and we're merely players on the stage. So don't blame anybody for this. Blame the play itself, the script. Where does this script come from? From the very idea from which existence arises, which is the idea of trying to replace reality with a new reality. It all comes from that. Once you see that, then you're capable of seeing the rest of it. And what you will also see is that reality cannot be replaced. In fact, all attempts to do so have had zero effect on reality, and always will have zero effect. And seeing that, you lose fear of seeing what's truly going on here in the world. And you find out what's really going on, the true purpose. Now, the true purpose of this flash crash of 2011 is to bring about tremendous misery here. That's the purpose, and it's going to be very effective in that. Now, there's a story behind this as to why this would be the script. It's a most intriguing story, but it's a challenge for you to listen to this and hear it. The idea of replacing reality with a new reality is an impossibility. All it can do is spin out a story of a hypothetical scenario of plausibility. And that's what existence really is. It's not actual. What we're seeing is hypothetical. It's plausible, but not actual. Okay? Super important differentiation there between the plausible and the actual. The attempt to replace reality has to start out with trying to negate reality, to get rid of it. And so the hypothetical scenario spins out a story of plausibility involving construction and destruction. It's a dualistic dynamic. Of course, if you want to destroy something, you have to have that something constructed first. If you want to cut down a tree, the tree has to grow first, obviously. So the desire to give plausible evidence that reality can be replaced, it has to give evidence that something, a symbolic, hypothetical scenario of plausibility, means that constructs will arise that symbolize reality, and then those constructs are destroyed, and that symbolizes the destruction of reality. It gives plausibility, okay, but not actuality. Now, this has been going on ceaselessly from the very beginning of this idea, and we're tired of it. Even greater than that, we're bored with it, because it's the same old song. Same song. Different singer, different singers come on the stage, but it's the same song. And we're incredibly bored with it. It is boring. Over and over and over, construction, destruction, construction, destruction. Ceaseless cycles of that. But profoundly bored with it, because it is very boring. It gets nowhere. It's going around in circles. When we get in touch with our boredom, that's the key. That's the key moment. And we realize, oh my gosh, this boredom is a horrible feeling. I don't want to feel it. How can I get free of this feeling? And that's when we sober up and get serious. Really serious. When you get really serious, you start finding real answers. So in order to keep this hypothetical scenario of plausibility plausible, there's a great priority on avoiding feeling this extreme boredom at all costs. For if you feel this boredom, you will then begin to awaken. You'll search for real answers, and you'll get them. And you will see what's really going on, and you'll choose a different idea. Instead of trying to replace reality, you'll decide not to replace reality. And then you'll experience, your experiencing will be very wonderful and different. So this hypothetical scenario of plausibility has to prevent this boredom from being really felt, directly, clearly felt. It goes to great lengths to prevent this. And yet it's not always successful. Now, what has happened over the last century in this planet is that so many people have reached a level of affluence with access to material things and comforts that they have realized that this isn't the problem. The lack of those was not the problem at all. And then they began to feel this boredom, and they say, my gosh, I've got everything, and yet I'm still completely unhappy and tremendously bored, and there's no excuse for it. And then they started to look at this and feel it and say, my gosh, this is serious. So many people began to realize that materiality wasn't the solution. And this led to a tremendous upswing in listening to great spiritual teachers. And many people began turning in this direction. And there was an opportunity for a great awakening to take place here in this world. This tremendously threatened the entire scenario of plausibility. And this hypothetical scenario of plausibility has taken great, great efforts to pull the rug out from underneath the affluence of this planet, and to plunge the planet back into tremendous poverty and misery. Why? Because from that position, it's extremely easy to make excuses for one's boredom. One can say, if only my external circumstances were better, then this boredom would be resolved that way. And so then another cycle takes place, you see, of so-called progress or constructivity, where people never even challenge the basic assumption. They just say, well, if I had, didn't have to worry about food and lodging and transportation, if I had all that and I had all these wonderful things, then I'd be happy. But you see, we know, those of us who have lived here on this planet during the last 100 years or so, we know differently now, because we've had all those things, many of us. Certainly, not all, but I'm speaking of the more advanced countries that have had this affluence. A lot of us have began to realize, holy cow, this isn't it. Doesn't matter what I have. I could live in a palace, on my own resort, and have maids and servants and, you know, thousands of shoes and clothes and everything. And I'd still be just as miserable and unhappy and bored with existence. And then realizing that, one gets very, very sober and serious. Okay? And then answers begin to arrive. So, there's been a tremendous effort and a setup to pull the rug out from underneath all this affluence the world has and to plunge it back into chaos and misery and suffering and tribalness and primitiveness. And there's many, many who have come into this planet with that sole objective now to participate in that. And you've seen them. You've seen them. The barbarians have come into this world en masse as part of the plan to plunge this planet back into destitution so that affluence cannot be experienced by many. And therefore, there can be an excuse to not really get serious about looking at boredom and where it really comes from. You see how that works? Very simple to go over it again. If you've got everything materially, just about, and you know, you can buy any clothes you want, you can vacation where you want, you can go play golf when you want, you can eat the finest foods and go to restaurants and just everything, beautiful home, beautiful landscaping, surroundings, all of those things. All the books, access to all the knowledge and the history of the planet, you name it. Have your own laboratory or work area, wonderful friends, everything. Music, tremendous music. We have that all now. So many have basically that setup. You then feel that you're still completely miserable, completely vulnerable, completely in a situation that you don't like. Something's not right. You then can feel that boredom and realize it's not coming from lack of anything external at all. Then that immediately puts you on what's called the spiritual path of seeking real answers. But conversely, if you live in a barbaric world of deprivation and misery and suffering, you will feel that boredom and you will easily be influenced to believe that your problems stem from external conditions, and therefore you will spend all your effort working on those external conditions, trying to improve them, and you will refuse to seek the true root of suffering. And thus you will experience great delay. And you will not choose a new idea for a long time. You'll keep pursuing external improvement. So, again, the upcoming collapse is by design. It's scripted. And it's done for the purpose of plunging this planet and people into absolute misery, which provides them with a great excuse to not choose a new idea, but to stick with this idea of trying to replace reality. And you get to choose. You don't have to go along with that scenario that this planet's going to go through. There are options. I believe you can find yourself in a very wonderful, extremely beautiful, affluent type of situation. Perhaps another dimension, who knows exactly, but It is that option is there. The fact is that finding yourself in a wonderful place does remove the excuses from you and brings you face to face with your misery. And therefore, you got to get serious. But that's a great thing. Great thing. No more miserable place than paradise. And yet it's very effective in your awakening. Have that beautiful mansion, you know, and the vineyard, and the dogs, and everything, the horses, and then find out just how miserable you still are, and how unfulfilled and bored you really are. Very, very helpful. That's my wish for everybody, that they live in a place of tremendous beauty and affluence, so that they have the opportunity to not make any more excuses. And I wish everyone has perfect health, so that their health is not ever an excuse. They can't say, well, if I only felt better, had more energy, then, you know, I'd feel happy. That's an excuse. Doesn't matter. You can be perfectly healthy and yet still feel completely bored. You can be on the most beautiful golf course in the world, in the most beautiful hole, sparkling weather. You feel great. You've got great food and company. And you look at that hole and you realize, my gosh, I'm so bored. You know, I just don't feel like I'm getting anywhere, really. This is all so boring. That's a deep feeling. Of course, you'll be trying to shake that off. You know, I got to make a good shot here to this hole. But something inside you is telling, this isn't it. Even this isn't it. I've got it all. I've got everything that I could hope for. And yet, this isn't it either. How long am I going to keep chasing something even better? Or shall I take a look at this feeling of boredom and say, where does this come from? Why is existence so boring? And then you start finding out, because it's futile. It's futile. It's only hypothetical. It's only plausible. How can plausible happiness is not actual happiness. We'll never be actually happy with this idea of trying to replace reality because it's all only plausible. And you start paying attention to that. You start paying attention to real teachers who understand this. And they start telling you, hey, you know, you're trying to create a new identity, a new reality, and that's futile. You already have a perfect reality. It's perfectly unaffected by attempts to destroy it. You already have what you really want. You already are what you really are. Forget about this becoming. Forget about this attempt to replace reality. It's nonsense. You start listening to that, you start hearing it, and you start becoming wise and start going towards choosing a new idea, exchanging this one idea for another one that's better. The idea of not trying to replace reality is a great idea to choose. Interestingly enough, many people will choose to go the route of misery and excuse-making. And they'll be cast down into what people call hell, you know, very miserable conditions. And then they have an excuse. Say, I'm unhappy because of these conditions. Because they're afraid to face the spiritual path. But it's really a wonderful opportunity, the spiritual path. It's difficult. But it's a wonderful opportunity because you see freedom is possible. It's just a matter of continuing to work towards it, give efforts of clarification. So it's nothing to be afraid of at all. Not at all. Satsang is just sitting and listening to someone, a teacher, clarifying for you and bringing these things up. It's not boring. Satsang is not boring. I can tell you that for sure. Having felt the boredom and knowing what it's all about, I can tell you that listening to spiritual teaching is not boring. It might be frustrating because you can't quite understand it, but it's not boring. There's a quality to it that's less boring than anything else in existence. Now, I won't say it's totally free of boredom, but it's less boring, okay? By far. The least amount of boredom that you can experience in existence is to attend satsang, listen to satsang, listen to teachers, give you clarification. So you can choose that. That can be your destiny path. That's what I'm saying for everyone, to choose that path. Don't be scared in the slightest bit. Because you're just being reminded. That's all. Just reminded of the truth. You don't have to be pulled along by the games of this hypothetical scenario, the dynamic that is continually unfolding us in misery again so we have an excuse. You don't have to accept that excuse. You can say, no. I don't want that excuse. I want to continue in a beautiful, affluent situation so I can really feel the true teeth of the boredom and the lack of any excuse. And therefore, I can really say, wow, I've got to sober up, get serious. Really, really apply myself to finding out what my options really are. You can choose that. That's what I say. Choose that way. Forget about the path of misery and suffering. All it does is provide excuses for you that are futile excuses. It's like if you have an illness or pain, you take the painkiller, you know, and then you experience side effects from that, and you're saying, ah, I feel terrible, I'm feeling all these side effects, it's awful. And then you're trying to treat those side effects, and you're not even treating the pain at all, really. But if you don't take it, the medicine, you feel the pain, and you say, where did this pain come from? And then you start paying attention to that. But if you take a painkiller, then you're not inquiring into where the pain come from. Now you're inquiring into where the side effect come from. And then you start treating the side effect with another medicine. And another and another and another, you see. And you're going around in circles, but you're never even getting into the true inquiry of where did the pain come from in the first place. Same thing with the boredom. Where does it come from? If you keep doing things to distract yourself from the boredom, give you excuses, then you're never going to really inquire into it. And you go into a barbaric situation, you're going to have immense distraction from that. You're going to be fighting for your life, survival, you know. See, and you'll say, gee, I my problem is survival here. It's not boredom. I mean, I got to try and figure out a way to get some food and water here and fight off the enemies and stuff. And you don't give yourself the opportunity to really inquire into the underlying great boredom of the situation. So it's much, much more helpful and effective for you and everyone to choose a very affluent situation, okay? And from that standpoint, you won't be worrying about where is my food and shelter coming from, and you know, how am I going to survive, and all of this. You know, you'll be saying, everything is great, but I'm sitting here, and I could do anything I want to do, but I've already done it all, and I'm very bored. And suddenly you'll feel this profound boredom and say, whoa, what is that? And you really will start paying attention to teachers, and they'll tell you where it's really coming from. It's coming from this idea of existence. That's where it's coming from. The idea of trying to replace reality is a futile idea. It never actually takes place. So it does the same thing over and over and over. Construction, destruction, construction, destruction, construction, destruction, endlessly. That's all it does. It's like watching a clock. The hands of a clock go around. How long can you do that? Literally, I mean, that just watching time go around and around and around and around and around, and you realize that's all it ever is going to be. It's just that. If you realize that, but watching a clock, nothing's ever going to happen except those hands going around and around, you will feel very bored. And you'll say, holy cow, I've got to find out another option. So existence, it's just that. It's just time going around and around and around and around. Construction, destruction, getting nowhere. Absolutely nowhere. All 100% futile. And that feels very boring to you. So don't distract yourself from that boredom. Put yourself in a place where you can feel it and then inquire into it. That's the remedy. That's really the remedy. The people who get truly free and choose a new idea are those really who find themselves in positions of affluence where they everything, you know, silver platter type of thing, and they just feel like, you know, they get into the inquiry. They start inquiring into their boredom. Now there are others in affluence who don't do that, refuse to do it, and end up very, very messed up. The opportunity certainly is there. I mean, you can be extremely bored and try to distract yourself. The wealthy can do that by all sorts of drugs and that type of thing. and a deprived lifestyle, sophisticated, degenerate lifestyles that they desperately pursue to try and get rid of this boredom. You know, that's possible too, but that's foolish. You know, they can buy more and more expensive booze, you know, that type of thing. But that's a foolish way to go about it. The others, they seek out spiritual teachers. That's the wise way to go about it. And they'll travel anywhere to see a teacher. And they'll pay attention to the teacher. You know, they'll really get into it. They got the means to do that. Everybody should have the means to go see a teacher. That's the most important thing. You should have the capacity to travel, to go, and the capacity to attend satsang. If a world is not making that possible for you, then it's not a good world for you. It's too barbaric. Because of excuses. You say, well, I can't get there because it's too expensive. I don't have the means. That's an excuse. You don't want that excuse. You want a world where you say, I can travel wherever I want to travel, whenever I want to travel. If there's some teacher there, you know, way distant, I can travel there and spend as much time as I need to. That's the right world. And you should have a world where there's many, many teachers. So, easy access. Not just one or two in remote locations, but easy access. Lots of teachers. Lots of affluence. Lots of boredom. Lots of impetus to access those teachers and their wisdom. And that'll result in lots of awakening. That's the right path to take. Forget about the barbaric and the primitive and the tribal. Forget about it. That's the path for fools. You've come too far to be a fool. And there it is. That's the cat out of the bag continuation. Explaining what's really going on. Collapse is intentional. It's purposeful. And it will be tremendously miserable. Be aware of the options that will be presenting themselves in the future. During 2012, options will present themselves for your destiny path. Options to go into an affluent situation, good situation. Or options to go into a very primitive, barbaric, savage situation. Those options will be on the table. So choose wisely. Choose wisely. Very good. Thank you. Thank you for having the attention span to listen to this. That's great.